Johnson and Vine. We went out there and we surveyed and came up with a database of all the different utility boxes out there. There's many different types, but there's one specific type that DOT approves for our work. So we found 10 locations in Sunset and we mapped them. And then we formed a partnership with an arts organization called the Do Art Foundation. They helped us with kind of the curatorial aspect and working with artists. So what they did was we worked directly with them to come up with a call for artists, which established some kind of basic criteria, what we were looking for. We set up a website with an online application process. And they helped us get the word out. So through this process, we received roughly 45 submissions, and they helped us narrow down those submissions to roughly the top 11. And I'm gonna run through some of the art that was submitted just to show you kind of the scope and the different techniques and quality of what was received. So again, these were just some of the submittals.
So it's just a wrap.
So it's a wrap. It's a 3M vinyl wrap, yeah.
So people did the artwork to submit and get paid for the submittal.
Not for the submittal, right. So some of these they did custom, some of them they just used examples of what they've done in the past. Some are a little, you know, different.
I wouldn't like that.
Yeah. And so we vetted all of these selections through our streetscape committee, and we narrowed it down to, I believe it was the top two, and we brought that to the executive board to hear their input. And then ultimately you have to get formal approval through the council district. They have to write a letter supporting the selected artwork, and then DOT gives you formal approval to install. So this was the artist that we actually ended up with, Paige Emery, and they're all local artists. That's a requirement of the application. The group really liked this artist because they thought it was very reflective of the vibe in Sunset and Vine. So we'd really be looking for something that represents the neighborhood, whether that's incorporating architecture or, you know, special sites. It needs to be reflective of that. And I think for Hollywood, we would be looking for something that's a little bit more, you know, typical Hollywood. So this is what we went with for Sunset. And then these are all up right now. We finished about a month ago, so they're along Vine and Sunset. We've got 10 utility boxes that were wrapped. This is just to kind of show the process. This was the first draft. This artist actually did hand-painted canvas work. And again, as you saw, some were digital imagery, photos, so kind of a diverse array. So we started here. We did some editing and some refinements to the original paintings. We brought kind of the first draft back to the streetscape committee, and based on our kind of discussions and input, the artist went back and made some refinements, which got us to this point. And then this was printed on 3M vinyl and wrapped around utility boxes. We also have QR codes and our logos on them as well, which was added later. But the project culminated in this kind of cool kickoff event. Because the artist in her artwork represented local bands, they were all bands that have performed in the area, local venues, we decided it would be appropriate to have a kind of a mini concert. So two of the bands that were portrayed in the artwork actually did a performance at Amoeba. We had a great crowd, and we had the artwork, the original art pieces on display. So it's kind of a mini gallery kickoff event. And that resulted in a lot of great media coverage, so this really got the word out. Then I will also show, we put together a project webpage that we're proposing to do as well, if this is approved for Hollywood, but you can see we created a landing page for public art on the utility boxes, if you scan the QR codes, it'll redirect you to this art webpage. Tells you about the project, about the artists, their concept. And this one was cool because we actually integrated a kind of an interactive component. You can hear the band, the music that the band created on each box. So there's that. Okay, so what we're proposing is a $10,000 budget allocation for this project. You can see the breakdown for Hollywood, for Sunset rather. We paid the artist a $2,000 stipend, which pretty much covers the cost of materials. The production materials and installs for the 3M vinyl wrap, was $6,000. And then we paid the Duart Foundation a $2,000 curatorial fee. For Hollywood, we've changed it just slightly. We're still proposing a $2,000 stipend for the artists. We're bumping up the materials fee to $7,000 because based on the partnership that we're proposing with the Arts Council, we kind of shifted some of the responsibilities from our previous partnership, so we were able to get that number down. And then that gives us a little bit more wiggle room if for whatever reason the install or 3M vinyl costs are higher than we anticipated.
Same number of boxes.
10 boxes, yeah. So in your packet, we've got, it's the blue page and then the white page. The white page shows you the proposed locations that we're considering. We did identify 10 boxes just so we could kind of use the same templates and models that we did for Sunset. There were more than 10 boxes out there. There was about 15 or 16. So this shows all of the locations along Hollywood Boulevard. Then,
how long can they stay out?
We have permission for a year.
And maintenance on them, because they're vinyl, right? So
they're vinyl, yeah.
They get ripped easily.
So
they've been pretty durable.
Yeah, they've been really durable. The materials cost includes graffiti coating as well. We've only had, the boxes have been wrapped now for about a month, and we've only had one minor tagging, and it came off really easily, so they're holding up really well. And then, so you can see here, this is what we're proposing for this partnership with the Arts Council, and basically what it comes down to is the Arts Council will do all the handlings with the artist. So working with the artist, putting together the call for artists and getting all of the submissions, compiling them, narrowing them down, and then actually bringing the selections to the board for consideration. And then from there, it would be passed off to us, the bid, to actually do the install and working with the vendor and things like that. So. That's what we're proposing, and we're seeking approval for $10,000 from the beautification budget to do this.
Do you have a question?
Sure.
I know for this year
we
want to start really branding.
Do
we have a
logo? Yes, we will. Yeah, we'll have logos on all of the boxes.
Is there any other questions? Anybody else?
I have to admit that if the motion is made, I'll probably vote against it for a couple of reasons. The biggest one is $10,000 for 1 year. I don't know if it's exactly cost efficient, so to speak. And over time on Hollywood, we're really subject to somebody coming up and slapping on a concert promotion or whatever it is, and then all of a sudden they start getting wrapped up. But also, on a bigger picture, I'd like to maybe see these utility boxes, because they are sizable, incorporated into our room branding of Hollywood, where we can actually have some more information for tourists to come. So, Arrow Chinese Theater that way, something like that. And have that a little bit more fluid so we can continue to make changes as we go through. Because at the end of the day, $10,000 for 1 year, I don't know if it's really the right thing. Wait, when we allocate these kind of projects, it's usually for benches that are supposed to last
5, 10 years, trash can are supposed to last years.
Yeah.
So I'm a little hesitant as far as.
Sure, I will say that DOT, it's a pretty strict program on what we can and can't do.
Right.
The logo was even pushing it, but we are allowed to do that. So some of those other ideas, they would not be allowed under this program.
Got it.
Has the sunset reminder already voted and approved?
Yeah, they're out there. It's done.
They're out, yeah.
It's done.
They're out, yeah.
So we would be matching.
But with your own unique style and artwork and whatnot. And I think what we're finding, you know, a lot of the bids in LA and actually throughout the state are embarking on these programs. There's something about, you know, artwork that kind of obviates against graffiti. So, and they're also, they are protected, so they can be easily cleaned and whatnot. But that's kind of what we're finding is that it's almost preventative.
Yeah, and you know, we do need to spend our beautification dollars. We still have $55,000 that's unallocated at this point, so we do need to spend this on.
I think anything we do to help beautify the area only helps the overall aesthetics, obviously, right? It's really no different than putting money in the landscaping, maintaining that. But at the same time, just a small investment in helping bring business back into the area as we continue to build it back up again. So it's important to maintain aesthetics.
But also, when it's $10,000 for the year, that doesn't mean, does it, that they're taken down after a year?
You know, I would be inclined to leave them up until we're told to leave them down, so it could be longer than a year.
Well, what's it for 1 year?
It's just the DOT program that's been set for a year.
Do you have a contract with them?
It's not a contract now, it's just guidelines, but they do give us a
just a point of information, the shadow sculpture project that was done 10 or 15 years ago, those were supposed to be for a year. Most of them were up for close to 10 years. Now, they were on private property, so it's a little different, but you know, I don't think they're going to necessarily, I think they'll last longer.
Yeah, we'll milk this thing if we can.
And the material fee's been, the cost is already there, so I think if we can.
It's been about a month, maybe a little longer than a month now.
So I'm just going to just put this out there now for it. Do you want to contest it? Because they're there, we both spent $10,000 to longevity, what it does to it, because we don't really get to do it today. I mean, I just.
Sure, yeah. The process in Sunset took a lot longer than I expected, just kind of the application process, the revisions with the artists. So we're hoping to get this done in this budget year. So to accomplish that, we would need to get started pretty quickly.
The streetscape maintain them? Are they the ones who will are clean them up, so to speak?
Yep.
I think this is part of our job. I think it's creative and I think it's a solid thing. Even though we're standing, I hear what you're saying, Mel, and you never know down the road how we change these things. But
well, we're not limited to, nobody's going to come out in a year and rip them off and say that your year is up. Yeah, to your point, these projects can be indefinite almost.
Collaboration is worth it.
Is that a motion?
I will move to do this.
I'll second it.
I appreciate what Gal said, for sure.
How about a form? Y'all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Are you?
I'm.
Are you opposed, Gal?
No, we're good. We'll go with it.
Okay, great. So you have your funds there. Do we want to go back to the maintenance contract?
Or the CPI?
CPI first?
So I went back and just looking through the minutes. Since 2009, we've only put into effect the CPI increase 2 years. 2010, it was 1.3%, and 2014 was 1%. Every other year, the board in that time period has opted to not raise it. So this year would be 1.7. So, like you said, with no CPI, we're looking at probably a $50,000 increase on our total assessments. With the 1.7 increase, on top of that, it's pretty large increase of $113,000 for what I calculated. So this
Doesn't have to be, yeah.
So I think what the recommendation is, 1.7 CPI increase, but it's up for discussion, the 0.2, 1.7.
I'd like to not see a CPI increase for a couple of reasons. First of all, we're getting an extra 50,000 with the reassessment, number one, and we are still carrying balances. We still have money that we technically haven't spent. And until we get to a certain point where we are tapped out and we've got new projects lined up ready to go, I would just as soon not have an increase.
I go along with that.
Is there any other counter argument to that? Okay. Is there a motion to institute a 1.7% CPI increase or 0% or 0?
I'll do 0 or no increase.
I'll second it.
Okay. All in favor? Any opposed? And any abstentions? So no CPI increase.
Votes unanimous?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So back to the contract.
Yeah, just we just want to continue to keep you in the loop for the last month, for this month to sunset as well. We've been running into some performance issues with Queen Street, who's been a long time streetscape vendor here. Matthew has been requesting documents for them. We had talked about kind of doing an in-house audit of their services. After numerous meetings and continuing to ask for these documents, they've been very slow in getting them to us, which has only further frustrated us, and we've continued to have slip-ups in the meantime, which Matthew is doing a great job of documenting. So we just want to put the board on notice that we're going to be meeting with the streetscape committee. We're doing a call, I think, next week. We're trying to set up to talk about what are our next steps going forward. There are a couple of vendors that finished very well in the RFP process. We spoke with Mark, who is the former chair of the streetscape committee, who could not be here today, but kind of gave him a heads up about it, and he felt that he would definitely be open to maybe even entertaining discussion with some of those vendors to see if they would be willing to pick up the contract. And so it's very preliminary, but like I said, I just want to put everybody on notice that we could be heading in potentially this direction. We'll know more after we talk to the streetscape committee next week and see what they think, but for no lack of effort on our part, I really believe Matthew's done a lot, and I've done a lot personally. We've had meetings, lunch meetings, and I truthfully can't even say if I know that they really want this contract. So it just seems like, in terms of how they're performing and the response that we're getting, more so from their management. Than
do we have any remedy at all? We're in the middle of a contract. Do we have any?
We have a 30-day out for any reason.
For any reason, 30 days.
Yeah, 30 days out. And so,
do they have a cure period?
I don't believe so. Do they?
So we think so.
No, I don't think so.
Question, have you made any formal demand for the document saying if they aren't provided by a specific date, we will consider dropping the contract? Dropping it yet?
We have not been that abrupt, but I think we've gotten that.
I think you need to.
We're a little hesitant to do that, and I'll tell you why, is that we're already seeing a drop off in service that I mean, the board can tell me otherwise, but personally, I feel like I kind of still want to hold our cards close to the vest because I'm worried that if anything that we do is going to trigger a further, you know, slack off in performance, to be truthful with you guys. And I don't think we can afford that right now. I mean, the boulevard needs to be cleaned, and it's in a very, very challenging state as it is right now. So my own personal, and like I said, you can direct me otherwise, but my own personal feeling is that I think we need to continue to figure out what the streetscape committee wants to do, potentially interview some of these other vendors that finished closely in the RFP, see if they would be willing to honor their proposals that they gave us back 2-3 years ago, and then go from there, put Queen Street on notice, and then let them determine what they want to do.
Yeah, it's much more than them just not turning in documents of your request.
But still, I do think you can be in a very positive way, just communicate in the document, so there's a paper trail.
Yeah, we have that.
Got it.
We definitely, Matthew's, I mean, like, yeah. I said, we've gone to lunch and he's emailed, he's asked by Thursday, if you can please get us by Thursday. We still can't get a straight answer. And, yeah.
What's the contract size?
It's just right around $1 million a year.
It's the second largest.
It's around $900,000 a year.
What day is the streetscape committee meeting?
It's Wednesday.
So since this is going to be on the streetscape agenda, I would encourage any board member who wants to weigh in on this, because that'll, you know, streetscape committee will kind of guide us on next steps, and we have Jeff here as well. So we'll look at that contract also and see if there's any, if we preliminary things we should, you know, be alerting them to, so that it's not a surprise.
Well, I mean, if they voice something that they're not happy with doing, performing or something like that, then you're just basically, you know, waiting for the eventuality that you're going to have to dump them anyway. It would be good to have to first check with the other vendors and see if anybody was in them, so you've got a fallback position. But without being rude or nasty, you just basically, it's business. If they don't get you the document, they've had plenty of time. That's part of what they're supposed to do. And some of the job they're doing, I don't know if they're the ones that are supposed to be handling Hollywood and, okay, and also over where the shuttle bus is on Argyle and Selma. I went walking by there and it's like nasty.
Well, this is why we're doing this audit, and I've been noticing a lot of these cases. So.
And maybe their own internal problems or management, whatever, staffing, but the better thing is, I think, to get your other ducks in a row if they do go by the wayside. If they're not performing, they may have internal problems that we do need to replace.
I would request, you know, they've been our vendor for a while, and I know we talked about increasing the use of technology in terms of performance. And I think that would help. So hopefully the vendors can choose to be able to have that in place.
We have an action item actually for that, so we can talk about that in a little bit. Yeah, definitely. It's a very good point. What we're finding is when we get to this action item, what we're suggesting as an action item would help us in the future going forward to hold our vendor accountable as opposed to the way we're doing it now.
Yeah. Joe, I'm with Joe. He's got it right here. They're our clients. Right? If they're not performing the service, I don't think we need to treat them kid gloves.
Right.
I mean, we have to keep the streets clean.
Believe me, I mean, if I'm coming across politely, it's to the board, not to them.
Okay.
So Matthew has been in discussions with me, and
right.
I've made it very clear where we are with them. To the point where I even told one of them at one point when he was complaining about stuff, I asked him directly if he even wanted a contract.
Okay.
So, yeah.
But how did they reply?
He was like, well, yeah, of course. Yeah, so, I mean, so.
Yeah. They're in the driver's seat if we don't have a backup. Yeah. So, yeah.
And then, I think that's a good segue, actually, to the
yes.
next item.
Okay.
So, the orange sheet here. So, this is a proposal to update and upgrade our existing operations management software. So take a look at this document. This is a proposal to upgrade our software to kind of the latest and greatest 2.0 version. It will enhance a lot of our capabilities, and it has a lot of rich features that would help with a lot of these issues that we're having with our current maintenance vendor. I think I'll have Joe talk a little bit about the features of the system.
Yeah, and just to reiterate, this is a proposal. We have a system that we've been using since 2007. The system was originally geared towards facility management, and we became the test case to use it for business improvement districts. And it's been wildly successful, but we have not upgraded the system since 2007. And what we traditionally used it for is for operations. And so, to Monica's point, and Carrie and Matthew and Devin, we've gone to these conferences with our trade organizations, and we are definitely behind the curve when it comes to technology. The stuff that we are using is, I mean, it's from the Stone Age. So we need to really get, you know, ahead of the curve, especially with the renewal coming up. And so what we did was Matthew and I reached out to our current vendor, and we had a good 3-hour kind of whiteboard session in here, brainstorming everything we would like the system to do and what it can improve to. And the benefit, I will say, with staying with our current vendor is that they're very familiar with our operations because they've been doing it since 2007. I have a great relationship with the president of the company where he knows us. We've used this system to track everything and anything we can. I always refer to it as kind of the ball of clay. You can mold it and do with it. There's stuff in this proposal that you'll see, but if there's ever anything down the line that we would want to track or change, it's very easy to do that with this system. And in good faith in doing this, I think he's given us a fair proposal, and also he has agreed to keep our monthly fee, which we pay around $425 a month for this bid. the same until 2018. And so the way that their business model is structured is a one-time setup fee and then a monthly fee going forward for unlimited users. A lot of these softwares, we looked at other softwares, and Matthew can talk more to that, but a lot of these softwares, you have to pay on a per-user basis, and that's how they make their money. This is a flat fee, $425 until 2018. And so what we're looking at with this upgrade is really just three essential features. We would be continuing to do the security, and we would be able to continue to monitor arrests. So not so much detailed arrests, but more so what type of arrest was it, alcohol, you know, urinating in public, whatever, you know, the type of arrest is, where it occurred, which bid it occurred in, when it occurred, and then be able to run reports from that. So we could say, it would start to maybe identify trends, like if we were, you know, making a lot of alcohol-related arrests in a certain corner, we could see that easily on the software, and maybe we could identify why. Maybe there's a liquor store there that's, you know, selling to people who are already inebriated, which is against the law, so maybe we need to reach out to the liquor store. So it's always, like I like to say with the software, pictures worth, you know, 1,000, right, words, so that's the joy of having this. And so the other side of it is maintenance, which I think is really the core component, which we're, what we're gonna use it for the most. So this gets to Monica's point that it would be much easier to audit our current vendor if we had something like this in place. So with the system, we're proposing doing a monitoring fee abatement, the removal of bulky items, a pressure washing schedule, street sweeping, tree watering, and trash receptacles. And Matthew has spent a lot of time working with Peter, who's the designer and owner of the company, and talk with him about how we would do that. It would all be done through a mobile application, so all of our guys in the field, through either Android or an Apple iPhone, could access the application. They would be able to do their jobs, note it, record it. Matthew would get an alert on his system here on the desktop, be able to monitor, and then ultimately go back and check. We could easily, right now, the way that it works, if we get a call and someone, Leslie says, when was the last time my pressure, you know, my sidewalk was pressure washed in front of our business? The way it works right now is Matthew would have to call Gus. Gus calls the pressure washing supervisor. They go back to the schedule and try to figure that out. Let us know. Whereas with this, you know, it'll all be pretty much a click of the button or a couple clicks, and we can tell you that easily. So it's really good from an accountability standpoint of managing our vendors. And then the last part is the bid management component, which is continuing to look at our parcels, tracking those parcels. There's when changes occur in parcels, we can do that through the mapping. This will be huge for us in bid renewal. We've used this software in the past. To generate maps to show who's been voting in favor, who's voting opposed, and kind of see where those are playing out. We can also keep track of parcel characteristics through it, so front footage, size, building square footage, and note those locations on that we can have. And then the last piece, and then I'll turn it back over to Matthew, is the maps are all what's called a vector graphic. So essentially, we can blow them up as large as we want or as small as we want, and we will not lose any quality of that. And that's been great too, because we've been able to generate some maps for the office in the past using this software. So that's kind of it from the overview side.
Yeah, and Peter actually came to our last streetscape committee meeting and did like a little demonstration, and some folks were there. Let's say, you know, do you guys have any thoughts, or what did you think of this?
Yeah, and my impression was the guy is so responsive. It's like having, Bill Gates at your Microsoft Word display on your screen.
And
he gets what we're about, and he's there, totally available.
Yeah, I have
to customize it.
Yeah, and I think he ended our committee meeting by saying that anything that you want the system to do, it he can program it to do it. Yeah, so.
I have two questions. One is, it's proprietary, so we are stuck to him. And if the company goes away, what is that longevity? Second question, which the vendors are including in security, essentially they all have their own system that we don't pay for. And they tie us into it. Maybe there's a component that for your parcels, we can do something with that. But this is something that I think that vendors should bring to the table, not at our cost.
So
I don't know how you can work that through.
So there's two parts to that. So let me answer the first question. So the first question is related to the proprietariness of the software. And so we, in our agreement, we own all the data that's in it. So should we ever leave, all the data is geocoded, every incident is geocoded. So essentially, if we went to any other software that had geocoding, which 99% of them do, it would be able to repopulate those maps and data from the data that we would be able to extract from the system, if we ever had to leave our software system, and including the maps are our property as well. So that's the first part. The second part is, so right now, the way that it's structured is Hollywood pays $425 a month, Sunset pays $225 a month, and then there's a portion that Andrews pays. Right now, the security vendor does pay for the software since they use it. Andrews will continue to pay that portion for it going forward. We pay more than Sunset because we have 794 parcels. We have, I think, 375 parcels, so that's why we pay so much more than
they do. How much does Andrews pay?
I think Andrews pays around $200 a month. I think it's around $200 a month. So what we could propose going forward, and some of the vendors that we've looked at, so to give you an idea, this isn't the only business improvement district they do, they've done others, but other maintenance vendors, where the software is in place, what they've done, for instance, I know one of the vendors we're looking at, they have foregone their own software and are using this software instead in their contract, and that was part of their contract setup, and that was later when they got the contract. So one of the vendors that we're looking at is already familiar with the software, and they know that they would have to bypass theirs to take this on, and then hopefully what we can negotiate is even them paying a portion of our monthly fee for us, if that's something that we want to do.
And that would mean we could keep kind of everything in one place, and we would have to use it.
Because they should be the one entering it,
Right, and we will, that's the thing, that whoever we go with, if we're going to spend this money, and we haven't talked about the cost, it's a $13,000 setup fee, of which Sunset and Vine approved half of that last month, so $6,500 is already approved by Sunset, so today it would be for you guys to approve your half of $6,500. And so if we're going to spend that kind of money, and the amount of time that Matthew has spent already with Peter, and then going forward setting this up, you know, I did it in 2007, I know how much time it's going to take. Ideally, whoever it is, if we even ever change security vendors or whoever in the future, if we're going to spend this much time, we have to somehow work it into, you know, whoever we hire is going to have to use this. And so I think, and you saw it, I think it's pretty user friendly from a user standpoint on the application. So I think anybody we hire, you know, whether it's a maintenance crew or a security officer.
And they'll have to provide the iPhones for their.
Right. That was the other question we were asking about, if they would have on the field, if they would have iPhones and be able to then actually use them.
Right.
And that question was asked of our vendors?
Yeah, I mean, I think all of our Andrews guys already have, you know, some type of device.
And
so
our street manager.
That'll have to be discussed.
And quick question on page 6, it shows a breakdown of the cost. I assume those are what make up $13,000?
Yeah, it's actually $12,000. Matthew and I suggested Matthew and I suggested just putting in $1,000 for a bunker there. That's why it's 13.
Just out of curiosity, why is this one for Sunset 50-50 when it's usually pro rata?
That's the same question they asked because they wanted to pay less. So my reasoning for doing that 50-50 is that they're going to be using the software just as much as you guys do. There's no set time in terms of differential in. It's not like the parcels, like I said, like it's easy in any case, but that's one.
I agree with you.
I wasn't young.
I think you need to upgrade from the floppy disk that you guys are using.
Yeah.
This is almost a gimme.
From the copper small floppy, it's not the 5-inch.
That's
right.
That's probably a Commodore.
Yes. Is there any questions for Joe or Matthew on this?
My general sense of hearing that Peter's presentation was, it looks really good. It's not, you know, I'm not smart enough to actually really analyze it, but the fact that these guys love it and look pretty good is not the thing. So I'm not in support of this.
Okay, Kurt, you have any question again?
Sure, I'm saying I have crazy.
Well, you know what? And he gave us free rent, so we're not letting him over.
So,
and I'll second.
Okay, great. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay.
Monica, can I ask one question to the back of the letters? I'm just wondering, actually, on the utility box part, if we can go to access any of the 1% art funds that people are contributing to cultural affairs for this. Can we get some funding for this?
Yeah, so this perhaps a separate discussion, but we are talking about, the Streetscape Committee is talking about putting together a public art plan, which would actually help us work with VCA to get funding for projects that are ready to go. That plan is going to take months to develop, but once we have that plan, I think we have a better chance of getting funded. They want to see a comprehensive approach to our strategy. Yeah.
Yeah, so we'll. Yeah.
Yeah, but we're up, yeah.
Are you ready for some exciting tree conversation? Okay, so first up, we have the possible fusarium wilt condition of Perry Island tree at northwest corner of Hollywood and Vine. I'm sorry, I'm gonna read because I don't want to miss anything that Matthew included. So we first identified that the palm tree was starting to look unhealthy late last year, and it was reported that we reported the tree at the vendor and during annual tree trimming. Urban tree care. The vendor thought the tree was suffering from manganese deficiency and treated the tree with nutrient stakes. The tree didn't respond to the treatment, so a palm tree specialist named Dr. Hodel was brought in from the UC system to inspect the tree, and based on his observations, he presumes that the tree has a fungal disease called fusarium wilt, which is a lethal and terminal disease. So his suggestion is that we consult with a lab to identify the pathogen that causes the disease. And if the tree has fusarium wilt, it cannot be replaced with another Canary Island date palm because the pathogen is in the soil. So the suggested alternative tree replacement would be a male edible date palm, which is not susceptible to the disease.
Yes.
Male edible date palm? Yeah. Are we going to go through? So we're going to have the farmer's market, I guess, selling those dates.
So these are the 16 giant palms that Sarah installed a decade ago. Very expensive trees to install one. It's about $30,000. So this is kind of a big deal. We would have to coordinate with the trust because we might be looking at Walk of Fame repair. So we are going to take Dr. Hodel's approach and have the tree tested to see if we can formally diagnosed that it has this disease, but even then they said it's really hard to confirm 100%. So there are some things we can do to extend the tree's life, put it on life support, but we are looking to have to replace this tree. It's not dangerous, but I'll have to get their recommendation on how long we can, you know, keep this tree up. We would probably take that out of contingency or
maybe even the old HED 0408 account, which we need to use up because it falls within the boundaries of the original bid.
Yeah, we've got about 22 grand left in that account plus, you know, the beautification money that we don't have allocated.
One of the things we learned about fusarium wilt when we planted these trees is that it is sometimes transmitted by unsterilized clippers, yeah. And you know, our vendor is aware of it, and they said they use sterilized clippers. There's also another theory that sometimes rats or birds might go from one tree to another. And in the neighborhood I live in, there's a lot of Canary Island date palms, and you do periodically see those that have lost their crown. It is a disease of that species.
Yeah, and it's transmitted through air spores, so it's really impossible to determine how the tree.
Just a point of note, I had that exact problem with my former hotel. Mm-hmm. It's futile to fight, it's only a matter of time.
How close is it to the corner?
It's on the northwest corner, so it's right there.
Next to the old biggest spot right now.
Okay, you guys, I'm going to try to move the meeting room because we are on the time schedule.
Yes.
So, if you don't mind.
Okay, the next item is about the Great Streets Initiative sidewalk repair, and phase two of the maintenance program will begin the week of June 12th. The second phase will include filling in trip hazards along the Walk of Fame. The Bureau of Street Services is working in partnership with the Mayor's Office, the Historic Trust, and the BID to identify the most appropriate method of repairing trip hazards.
And let me just jump in really quickly. Oh, yeah. These are just some photos of the problem areas we've identified. A missing curb on the north side of Hollywood at Vine. Some tree wells that are not actually tree wells. And then also these old remnants as well. So BSS is going to clean up this mess for us.
Okay, and the only last thing I had was that they're currently testing a series of epoxy solutions to find the best match for the terrazzo.
Yeah, and I'll just show you those two options here. They haven't decided yet, but this is One of the options, Terrazzo, unfortunately, is not, it's not feasible due to budget constraints, but this is one of the options. I mean, it's, you know, this is the second option, which I think I prefer. I think it looks more kind of matte and ties in better, so they're still working on some color corrections and figuring out how to match it more closely. So those are what, those are the options on the table right
now. Out of curiosity, do we know what the cost would be to actually replace one of those?
I don't by memory, but I do have a spreadsheet. It's the cost is enormous.
Question, have they ever thought about utilizing whatever the, what, is that like a resin material?
The Terrazzo?
Yeah, with the patch.
Sorry, what's the question?
So is it like a resin as opposed to it's a cement type of?
It's an epoxy with a dusted coloring in it.
Silly question, can they add the stone and grind it?
So that's what they're still working on.
That's what they're
going
to do?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
I think these are would be interim measures. The trust has spent a lot of money on repairs, but $3 million so far. It's very expensive for more, and they have a, as they raise money, they repair things. So obviously the ideal repair would be to replace the whole square, but that's not cost effective temporarily. So the closer they can get to something that will match, I think the better, until such point as funds are identified to replace.
Yeah.
The way the Terrazzo. The Terrazzo is the original material and the historic material, so obviously we want to try to keep it as close to that as possible.
Sure.
Do you understand?
Okay. Now you're talking about blank squares versus ones with stars in them.
Just the blank ones.
I don't think I recall a figure for one square. 1 3-foot square of Terrazzo.
Without taking too much time, the problem is you basically can't just remove one Terrazzo panel very easily without impacting the other stuff that's around it. So it's not a simple thing of just digging out one and replacing another. And you're talking, you know, you pretty much get into the high four, low five figures.
Okay. And I mean, just along with that, you know, we're continuing to see the walk deteriorating dirt in certain areas, especially where we have ficus trees. Over the years, about half the ficus trees have been replaced. But as the ficus trees continue to get older and the roots start pushing up the walk, we're going to continue to have these issues.
Yeah, I can give a quick update on the community plan scoping meeting that we had this week. Was anyone else there from the board? I saw a couple of people. So this was scoping meeting for the community plan update. Not a lot has changed, but they are revising some land use policies and some zoning to reflect some new numbers, forecast projections for housing, jobs growth, population growth. So those changes consist of increasing some density in the areas around the subway stations and lowering the density in residential areas. So those are kind of the two main things. But the changes affect roughly 7% of the total community plan area. So again, it's not a huge change. They are expecting to release the draft EIR, the new draft EIR, early in 2017 for public comment, and they hope to pass that by the end of 2017. So they're on a fast track.
One quick point that deals with industrial space, which is generally south of Santa Monica Boulevard. They're looking to do a change on industrially zoned property. You can build residential or commercial or industrial, which you can't do the opposite on residential. They're looking to change the old law and in the Hollywood area, in this area. If you want to buy a property that's industrially zoned, bulldoze and build residential, you can't do it.
No infomercial from you.
Say again?
Buy property from you.
No. I don't own any down there, but I'm just saying it's a big change that is different from all of Los Angeles. So if you're looking to buy something and do a development for residential and it's industrially zoned, you're not going to be able to do it anymore.
Is there any in this district, do you know? In the
Hollywood,
in our bid, is there any property zoned?
I don't think so. Yeah. They're all south, but it's a major change for somebody looking to do some of those things.
There are only about 200 acres in all of Hollywood that are zoned industrial.
Yeah.
And 62 of those acres are Paramount Pictures, so you take that out of the equation, and we have very little.
Right. Okay, thank you, keep us posted.
Industrial, not commercial.
Industrial. Which is, for the most part, south.
Would you like to give us an update on marketing and communication?
Sure, I'm gonna let Leslie give the report mainly, but I'll just mention that we did have a meeting in here on Monday with WAG, and they also brought in a client, IMG, Scott, he flew in from New York. He has a background in working on music festivals. He was working with AEG when they started Coachella. So it's actually kind of a great fit because he already has this background, even though that's not necessarily what IMG does normally. So this could be a new kind of venture for them to partner with us on this festival. So I'll let Leslie talk a little more about the meeting and what our impressions were of IMG and WAG.
Well, they seem to be married in this project at any rate. And they're both very enthusiastic about it. And, you know, for obvious reasons, it's a tremendous opportunity for them. Well, I'll talk about them first. I mean, it's a great opportunity for them, for the WAG people, because if they get IMG in bringing in some talent and organizing it and getting it up and going in terms of entertainment, they can then, you know, position their craft beer in a way that's advantageous to them. I mean, that's the way, basically the way this business model works. I was thinking about it, and I actually know how this works. The festival, the music promoters usually run the thing, and then the concessionaire, in other words, the booze, they piggyback onto the music. And the music promoters benefit, usually take a percentage of the, and a healthy percentage of the income from the beer or booze generally. But in this case, it wouldn't, I don't know that we're ready to do it that way. But it seems like a place to start. They're enthusiastic, they have a lot of creative ideas, they have a plan, they're gonna go, the WAG people are gonna go ahead without us anyway. If we don't partner up with them or enable them, they're gonna do it without us. So it seems to me like a good way, at least this year and our second year, to get things going, to use them. And then see where we go from there.
We're waiting to hear back. They were going to tour Hollywood and look at the parking lot at Selma and Ivar and look at some other venues. And the gentleman from New York had a vision of actually having, it's like beer tasting. You buy a ticket for 3 hours to try a crowd of beers. Mm-hmm. And so his idea was to create people walking through the neighborhood, which is actually sounds appealing to us, that people are not locked into one place. But there might be multiple venues, and we are connecting them with, we discussed the Fonda, we discussed the vacant space at the Taft building, there are a couple of little parking lots, the alley, the arc light, the old Cordon Bleu space, you know, the courtyard of the arc light. So possibly they might even look at activating multiple venues over the course of those 2 days to encourage people to be walking through the neighborhood. So again, it's still conceptual. I really appreciate Leslie. She's been here for over 2 months this time, and so she's been able to be sitting in on all these meetings, and we've had people from the other bit as well to help us get these folks, and we're waiting to hear back from them on what the ideas might be.
Is there anything else? I didn't see your sheet, actually.
Yeah, they seem to be of the same mind as us that this is, you know, growing each year, so they talked about maybe establishing a 3 to 5 year vision plan for it if we do move forward with them. So I think that's great, kind of adding, you know, kind of determining how we're going to grow each year, looking into the future. I think that was about covered it.
And there's one other little piece, which is what we get from it, whether we can generate some revenue for ourselves from it.
Ultimately we'd like to find that out. For the first year, I think what we benefit from it is the foot traffic and all the people coming in through their marketing and their efforts to do this Tapped Beer Festival. We'll be getting a lot more people within our festival And they'll, you know, tie it in together and it'll be all branded as one experience.
Are you planning on helping us support like extra trash pickup or security?
We would definitely have that conversation.
Yeah.
Any music?
We have been working with MI, who very graciously agreed to donate the sound equipment. And they're also going to have auditions to find three of the acts for Make Music Day. This is a worldwide event on June 21st. We're working with the W and Metro to activate the W Plaza in front of the Hollywood Vine subway stop. So we have three different sources of entertainment, MI. We have a music curator that works in the TAF building that we've worked with before. And then the W itself also has two slots that they would like to program. So it would be from noon to 8 p.m. approximately on June 21st. And it would just be small acoustic acts performing with a new act every half hour. Yeah, and we are actually looking for sponsors for this. It would be funded solely through sponsorship. The title sponsorship is $1,000, and then artist sponsorships are $100 each. So we actually just need to get the one title and about 3 to 4 artist sponsors. So I will make sure to email you out that sponsorship form in case any of you would like to be a sponsor.
Yeah, we'd like to pay the students a stipend for participating. You know, we're asking people to do things for free. So $100 gets you in our sponsorship lineup to help pay the Musicians Institute students to perform for us and others.
Is Make Music Day a national?
It's a worldwide. We are this year piggybacking on Make Music LA, which is its own organization. Eventually, maybe we would start Make Music Hollywood, but that's a little more work. So for this year, we wanted to kind of dive in and just piggyback on what the Make Music LA organization is already planning. So we would be part of their events. We would be listed on their website.
Next. The Historic Hollywood Boulevard Ad Hoc Working Group. So we met on April 29th, and I'm going to just pass this along, just one copy. We are enlisting the help of our folks from Haynes & Co. Claire is kind of a whiz at branding, and through the combination of Claire and just the working group, which is Evan and Gallo and Mark Echeverria and Beth Andrus and Aaron, we've been having conversations about what is unique about this section of Hollywood, which we are looking to rename and rebrand. It's probably going to be leaning towards something that relates to old Hollywood. We're talking about the area from about Las Palmas to Cahuenga. And I'm just going to pass this around as some of the images and the colors and the history that we're unfolding about what is unique and what is seems to be this part of Hollywood is really where Hollywood started. And that might lend credence to a certain kind of branding sensibility that could be pretty cool for this part of the neighborhood. So we need to meet again. Matthew kind of walked us through some brainstorming about thinking about what could be done in the physical realm here that could be emblematic of old Hollywood. You know, we're talking about awnings and lights and you know pole banner accents or what have you. So we're going to do some further thinking about that, and we also have some ideas about different people we could connect with to see if we could either do some kind of a charrette or some kind of consultation with historic preservation experts who could help us in this journey that we're on. So more to present next month, but it's actually the funnest thing we're working on right now, because we really feel like we're uncovering something special here.
Yeah, and part of this would also be a walking tour. Initially, we would probably do it as like a blogger or journalist writer tour, and then depending on how that successful that is, we could open it up to be like maybe a weekly or monthly walking tour that people could sign up for and purchase a ticket to get an authentic old Hollywood tour. Because we have been working with April, our researcher, who has discovered that a lot of the first things in Hollywood, including the first post office, the first hotel, the first movie theater, were all in this section that we're talking about.
even if it's like a handout or something, because I, when I was coming here, I saw German family who just, they just saw their first stars right here, and they're like, who is it, who is it? They're all gathering around, but they didn't have any literature or anything, so there's kind of like, many people I think come to Hollywood and they're just, their first blush is just, they don't really know where to go. So it's interesting, it's a good idea.
And then the storefront project?
Sure, so we are working with our consultant. He's a gentleman who actually used to program the windows here when it was the Hollywood Book and Poster Store. We've given him a deadline of June 1st, which is rapidly approaching, so I believe he's ready to order materials. We are kind of marrying the imagery from our Hollywood infographics and some photos from our photo bank with kind of the old Hollywood book that you'll see in these panels. So I think the wallpaper on the back of the walls is going to be some sort of Art Deco pattern, so that way in the future we could swap out the current design for something that would focus on old Hollywood or on the music festival or whatever event is coming up. But the first set is just going to be the cubes that feature the different icons from the infographics and photos of our properties and property owners, and just messages about what we do here at the BID and who we are. So hopefully that will be up and in the window before the June board meeting.
So there's nothing new to report on skateboard enforcement. Our little group hasn't gotten back together. I just had it there as a placeholder on your agenda. A recent development involves the Greater West Hollywood Food Coalition. Many of you may be aware of this organization that has been had a daily feeding program down at Sycamore and Romaine in the media district for over 20 years. And over that time, it has not been without its challenges that it poses to the community, because it is a daily program, 365 days a year. There are the consequences of people not moving too far away from that program, and therefore camping out or staying very close to that intersection for long periods of time. And it has been a challenge for the neighborhood. There has been apparently a change in leadership in the organization. The gentleman who founded it, his name was Ted Landreth. He was very hard to negotiate with and did not really want to be in conversation with the neighborhood about the consequences of that feeding program. And they have formed a new group called the Friends of the West Hollywood Food Coalition. And he has now just one vote on that board. And they are looking for a new location, and they want to bring the outside feeding program inside. So we got an email, the community got an email a week ago Friday, that the Salvation Army had agreed to a 3-day test to invite the West Hollywood Food Coalition onto their property at Hollywood and Bronson to test the feeding program last Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday evening. And so that came as a surprise to everyone. What I immediately did was to contact the Salvation Army. As a neighbor and a property owner in the BID and on Hollywood Boulevard, we would really like to have a conversation with all the neighbors around the Salvation Army about how what they are imagining for this property, and why bring in an organization outside of Hollywood when there are a lot of other potential partner organizations within Hollywood that the Salvation Army could work with. So we made some headway last week. Hank Hilty, who is the CEO of the A.F. Gilmore Company, who owns the Farmers Market and the Grove and was honored at the Chamber Luncheon last Wednesday, had a long talk with him on Friday. I don't think he was aware that we have an organization in Hollywood called Hollywood Forward, which has a lot of nonprofits that are already working with the homeless population in Hollywood. The Salvation Army has never come to a Hollywood Forward meeting. The Greater West Hollywood Food Coalition does not come to these meetings. And he is on the board for the Salvation Army and on the advisory board for that particular property. and he pledged that there would be an opportunity to meet with the neighboring property owners. We've also reached out to the Salvation Army Social Service Organization in Long Beach, which is where the decision was made. And so, you know, we're going to hold him to that pledge that there will be a meeting and there will be a conversation. We're very, very concerned about the fact that there already is, in fact, I was going to show you, I put this in your packet. We've just had a considerable uptick in our homeless population over the last couple of years. And this is a, you know, we keep a, every month, the bid control will go out on the last day of the month and we'll conduct a count of visible homeless in Sunset and Hollywood. And if you just look at April 2013 to April 2016, that's about a 70% increase. And as I mentioned to Hank, you know, we have people here in this neighborhood that need to be served. We don't need to import another 200 people from Sycamore and Romaine. So we'll keep you posted on that. That has been kind of like the issue du jour of the last week. And yeah, that's all I can say right now. The next thing that I want to present is and thank you, Jeff, for being here today. We have been working with our attorney to create a kind of a more formal system for our Public Records Act compliance. As you know, Mr. Riskin here in the room has now probably filed about 150 public records requests in the last 20 months. And it's a very voluminous process, and for which there are multiple follow-up emails. And so we work with both of our attorneys to come up with a new system that actually will, I think, help everybody kind of manage this process. So I just want to kind of run through it with you, because we would like to adopt this tonight, and then it will actually be implemented immediately after this meeting, and it will go up on our website. So essentially, what we're doing here is we will have an email that people who would like to request records from the bid will email the admin@hollywoodbid.org. We will ask that this form be filled out and would articulate exactly what it is that the person is looking for. The form can be submitted in person, it can be submitted in mail, via fax, or via email to the admin email. Records can be inspected here in the office during by appointment only, during normal business hours. So we've got some of the specifications on how that would work there. We will log the requests that come in and date stamp them, and we will respond to them in the order in which they are received. If somebody has multiple requests pending, and if they're interested in moving something higher up on the list, they can waive a previous request, but we will respond to requests in the order in which they are received. We've also gotten guidance just on, you know, the amount of time that it would make sense for a staff of five people to spend responding to public records requests, so that it doesn't disrupt the business of this nonprofit organization. Let me see if there's anything else on the back here. That's kind of this would be on our website, and we also would lay out specifically that if anything is to be photocopied, it would be the individual would agree to pay the 15 cents per page. It would have to be paid in advance. If there's anything that is requires special processing or reproduction, the individual would have to agree to pay those costs. And electronic files will be provided to a requester via CD or flash drive, but the person will provide that media. We're not in a position to, you know, provide flash drives to people. Let's see, there's anything else. Voluminous and or complex requested records will be sent to an outside copy service. We will let the person know how much that will cost, and they will have to pay for that, you know, producing those records in advance. Are there any questions?
we're just going to review this for a second. I think we're going to get a chance to read it before they weigh in on this.
Just one question on the charge, 15 cents per page. Is that something that the state designates how much you can charge per page or covering?
That's what we determine our cost is.
Okay.
I think we've seen costs in various ranges. There's no state formula for that.
Any questions? Okay. Looking for an action to approve this policy.
One question about the charge. If I ever go down to any county office for public record, right, it's usually like a $25 fee. Is that something that could be considered rather than a per page?
We looked at, you know, there are other policies that actually charge for staff time, you know, to do this. And at this point, we're not electing to recommend that.
Okay.
If it seems necessary, we could certainly come
you
back.
You can always amend
that.
Change
it.
Okay.
I make a motion to accept.
Okay. Any second?
I'll second.
Are you all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? So we have a request that's taking effect immediately right now. Okay. Program priorities.
So, you know, we're beginning to tee up some activities to begin to kind of help people embrace the task that is ahead of us with bid renewal. One of those was to have a midnight walk, and since Leslie was the one who really requested it, and we just did not get an opportunity to organize it before she left, so I'm going to organize it for August when she comes back, and I'll let you all know what that option would be. I'm just curious, for any of you who might want to do the midnight walk, which is midnight to 3 a.m., would it be easier for you to do it on a Friday night or a Saturday night? My preference is actually a Saturday night. Only because I can take a disco nap beforehand. But I mean, does anybody have a strong feeling, or Leslie?
No.
No.
Okay. I think a Friday would be probably better. Because
really?
It's a weekend for you to do something else.
Okay.
Of course, you're not going to get home till 4 o'clock in the morning, but
yeah.
That's Saturday anyway.
Are there any particular venues that need to be seen that may change Friday to Saturday?
That's a good question. You know, actually, so many nightclubs have closed down.
Mm-hmm.
The LAPD is telling us that there basically is only one nightclub left, and that's Playhouse, because Cosmo is being closed down through the CUP hearings that they had, and, you know, Supper Club has closed. So it's going to look really different out there as compared to 3 years ago or so that when we were out there. And I think we would not only just walk, we might drive a little bit too, because we want to see the outer edges of the bid. Because part of this also is to help inform us on what we might want to do at night in the new bid as well. So, but that's a good question.
Would we drive a little bit like a shuttle bus or something?
Yeah, depending on how many of you are coming.
Well, I definitely want to go.
Okay.
It was worth it.
Okay, so Friday, it looks like a Friday in August will be the day. And then the tour of the bids, I want to get a bus to take you out just to both bids, whoever wants, just to kind of go up and down the streets of both bids to see the outer limits and what's unique about the other two bids. And so I'm looking at doing that on July 26th from 9:30 to 11:30, and then thought afterwards we would go somewhere for lunch. So I will send that out, and you know, those of you who are interested in doing that. Right. And we do, Monica does need to appoint someone to the nominating committee. You and I just haven't had a chance to talk about it, to fill John Lyon's seat, so we'll do that in coming month. Because Michael Gargano is on the committee, and Greg Beck, but John Lyon was on the committee.
He's a person. So we'll get back to you on that. Any ideas also, you can also elect a potential board member. that we can interview, and I know since we did this when Tony was joining us, there were a lot, you know, there are ideas going around, and I think we reached out again, but another opportunity if anybody has a suggestion. For the position and the nominating committee, yes, yeah.
So we were ahead of time, so this is great. The staff went to the California Downtown Association Conference 2 weeks ago in Oakland. And it's such a great gathering of the bids throughout the state because it allows us to really compare notes with what the other bids are doing with respect to their streetscape and maintenance and security and how they're addressing homelessness and whatnot. So we stayed in Jack London Square, and the way the Oakland bid set this up is that every session was in a different part of Oakland. So it wasn't at a hotel or in one venue. You were constantly walking or taking a shuttle and really experiencing all of downtown Oakland. So that was terrific. So I didn't remind you guys, you prepared to share? So Joe was heading to a family event in Texas, so he did not get to join us, but we thought we would each share with you maybe two things that we picked up and brought back from that experience.
Sure. So I was in a session talking about bid renewal and this question that has come up about general versus specific benefits. And so a lot of new bids that are renewing or forming have a small portion of their bid budget that is not garnered through assessments. So in the past several years, that's ranged from 1% to 5% of the budget. And some of the ways that bids have gotten this, a lot of them have just had the city pay that. I don't think that that's an option for us in LA. So other ways that you could get that revenue include membership or organization dues. If we formed a 501c3 nonprofit, we could have membership dues for that organization, foundation grant income, and events and programming. So I was interested in that, so I went to a session called Making Your District a Hot Destination, and there's a panelist from Long Beach, and they make over $2 million a year in event revenue. So we're actually, you can see that we have the next item is field trips in Long Beach is on there, because we would love to learn more about how Long Beach is able to make this kind of money from events, and that could definitely help, you know, fill that gap in our budget if we were to do some higher profile events that make money.
I'm trying to remember what I said at Sunset, but
and I didn't give you a heads up.
Creative placemaking was a big topic, as it seems to be in every conference that we're going to, but one of the things that kind of resonated with me was this idea to create a plan for everything that you're working on in terms of the public realm. So I sat in on this interesting session with the Yerba Buena Center in San Francisco. The executive director was on the panel, and they actually created this public life plan. So they identified these locations where they could have, you know, pop-up parks or performance art, and they used that plan to go after grant funding to actually implement. So I think the bids, we have such small beautification budgets that we can actually use that money to plant seeds, if you will, in the form of a plan to go after, you know, bigger funding opportunities. So, and that's kind of the direction we're heading. I mentioned the public art plan that we're thinking about doing. So it's nice to see that there's a precedent for doing something like that. Second thing, the thing that I like most about these conferences is talking to other people who work in the bid world. It's, you know, the one outlet you have to talk to people who do the same work that you're doing. And every single person I spoke to throughout the state, homelessness, you know, was the biggest concern for everyone. And I talked to someone who had just formed a bid on Polk Street in San Francisco, and they had a staff of 4, and 2 of those staff were dedicated homeless outreach folks. So we have a bid who half of their operations is dedicated to, you know, homeless issues. So that was interesting as well.
Yeah, and my two things were one of the themes that are kind of coming through these conferences, both at IDA and CDA, is beginning to address social equity issues in urban life. And a big issue in California right now is the gradual erosion of our affordable housing stock. And this
article I think Devin posed just about how the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative and other measures are making it more difficult for young people to actually, well, for you got people losing their housing, ending up homeless, got people doubling up, and we've got young people having a hard time getting a foothold in this economy because apartment costs are so high. And it was an interesting discussion that if places like California and arguably New York don't get this figured out, we potentially could lose like the younger creative class to other cities. The new cities that are attracting young people and jobs are being called rebound cities. So the example was used that in San Francisco, the median rent is $4,000 a month. In Cleveland, it's $700 a month. And so it's not going to be long before young people who want to start a family and, you know, have a quality of life are going to find themselves leaving the state. The whole issue of gentrification is certainly a very hot topic as well. And as San Francisco is bursting at the seams, they're beginning now to encroach upon Oakland. And there was some pretty impassioned discussions about how that's displacing people in Oakland. Yeah. So, I kind of came away from this thinking the state of California is experiencing a housing crisis, and local land use planning left to its own devices is not going to help the state in the long run. And the second thing is on the issue of special versus general benefits and bid, you know, formation of bids. And you're going to hear more about this in the coming months as we begin to tee up this process. It is kind of widely known now that when you form a bid, there will no longer be zero general benefit, which is how our bid has been, it's how we have been for the last 20 years, so that 100% of the assessment is specifically benefiting the property owner. Because of a whole series of lawsuits in different parts of the state, not for bids, but for maintenance assessment districts and street lighting districts, et cetera, the courts have generally found that you have to find some portion of general benefit. And it could range from 0.5 to, you know, 3 or 5%. There's ways to measure it. We're gonna have to probably hire someone to help us in this process. And whatever that delta is in your budget, it has to be paid for by something other than bid assessment. So in the case of San Francisco, you know, we learned that the Union Square bid had an annual fundraiser, and the property owners there buy tables and they raise $100,000, and that helps to pay their general benefit delta. So more we're going to learn about that, and as we start to like kind of widen our view of what's going on, we are reaching out to these other bids. We're going to travel to Long Beach. We went and met with our friends in the South Park bid a couple weeks ago and did a little field trip there. We're going to do a phone conference call with the Sacramento bid. We're learning about how other bids are approaching their programs, how they're governed, how their boards function, to bring ideas back to you as we begin to think about the future.
Anything else? That's it. Okay, next meeting is June 16th. Thank you.